My name is Tissa Salter. I'm a faculty member here at Kansas State Polytechnic, and it is my distinct honor to get to introduce our speaker today. But before I get started, how many of you have ever been tempted by one of those things they advertise on television where you can trace your recombinant family roots back to wherever, Africa, from a little dab of spit? Has anybody ever done that in this room? That baits me in because I really would love to know where I come from. How many of us think that we might be indigenous? Anything? Tara, you're indigenous. More on that later. I know I'm not. I'm a mutt. But we're going to hear about indigenous culture today and intersections of technology and many other things from Dr. Daniel Wildcat. But first, I'm going to talk a little bit about what it means to be indigenous. How many indigenous people do you think live in the world today that are truly self-identified as indigenous people? Someone take a guess. Hazard a guess. How many are there? How many people in the world are indigenous? All right, good guess. Well, a little high. And this is like, let's make a deal. 320 million people are indigenous. So one more quiz question. Where are the majority of indigenous people located? South America? We have one vote. Who said Asia? Gold star. Most of the indigenous people, in fact, according to the source that I was researching, 70% of indigenous people live in Asia, which surprised me. I didn't actually know this. There are 5,000 groups of people within the 320 million people that basically divide up into indigenous cultures. Those 5,000 groups speak 4,000 different languages. Some of those languages are so severely at risk, there are maybe 5 speakers of those languages, and linguists around the world are rushing to try to capture those languages before they permanently disappear from our world. So I looked up just to be basically what is indigenous, and I don't like to speak with notes, but I have to rely on notes. Indigenous people usually have or had their own language, cultures, traditions influenced by living relationships and ancestral homelands. Okay, indigenous people have distinct cultural traditions that are still practiced. Indigenous people have or had their own land or territory to which they are tied in myriad ways. Indigenous people self-identify as indigenous. So those are kind of our basic definitions of what it means to be indigenous, but it's far more complicated than that. It's also very interesting to note that 80% of the Earth's biodiversity is protected and controlled by indigenous people. And those people are under constant assault by governments and various corporations for extractive kinds of industries, mining, oil, you name it. We've heard about the Dakota Pipeline. You've heard all these different things going on. Indigenous people have been the stewards of these properties and still are so. And yet they are under constant assault and receive very little help from government and other entities to protect them. So, as I said earlier, it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Daniel Wildcat. He is a professor at Haskell Indian Nations University in Lawrence, an accomplished scholar who writes books. Some are here on this table. He's written many works of scholarship and has distinguished himself internationally, spoken to United Nations group and so on. You could not have a finer speaker for today's presentation. There'll be time at the end of the lecture for questions. Those of you who are feeling shy to ask your question, microphone, you may write it down on a piece of paper and pass it to me, and I will ask for you. Dr. Wildcat, thank you very much for coming, and let's give him a Wildcat welcome.
Thank Is the microphone working? Yeah, I believe it is. Okay. Sangele, Galasan, Yuchiha, Muscogeeha, Zoyaha, Kadana Yadane. What I just said is, how are you? Good morning. I guess it's afternoon now, technically. I am a Yuchi member of the Muscogee Nation of Oklahoma, sometimes known as the Creek Nation, the Creek Tribe. We're not Creeks, but we were a part of that confederacy for survival's sake in the late 18th and early 19th century before removal to Oklahoma on the Trail of Tears, along with the Creeks, Cherokees, Choctaws, Chickasaws, and Seminoles. And it's really an honor to be here. I want to thank Greg for the invitation, and I think it's the topic that I'm going to address today, I think, is very, very timely, because we live in an incredible age of uncertainty, and I think the uncertainty is, I don't know what institution is free of the uncertainty. I don't know whether you could talk about certainty in an economic sense of where we are in the world. I don't think you can talk about certainty in a ecological or environmental sense. I things are very uncertain, not to mention the political environment. So what I'd like today is to propose something. And what I'm going to propose is that in many respects, there's an opportunity now. There's an opportunity now to recognize, to try to restore to the extent that's possible, reconstruct in many cases, the wisdom of the first peoples of this land today. And it's desperately needed. There's an apocryphal story about Einstein, and if you can find, by the way, a citation for this, please send it to me, because I've used this many times in presentations, and you've probably heard the quote I'm going to give you. But the story goes like this: after Einstein had escaped the Nazis and had been set up at the Institute for Advanced Research at Princeton, along with a lot of other very bright scientists, the story goes that he was brought a physics problem that was troubling his colleagues. They couldn't figure out how to solve the problem. And the story says that, you know, they went in to see Einstein, and he was busy working with someone. He said, leave that on the desk. You know, come and see me tomorrow. And so the story says that the colleague comes in the next day and asks Albert Einstein, well, did you get any insight? I mean, do you have any ideas about how we might approach this problem? And this is the quote that's often used. It says, well, he says, I'll tell you this. Sometimes you can't fix problems or solve problems with the same kind of thinking that created them. We're in big trouble. Because the people who are proposing problems, solutions, are still working with the kind of thinking that created the problems in the first place. We have people on the planet who have very different ways of understanding our human place on the planet and what it means to live well as a human being. And I'm going today make the case that we have an incredible opportunity at places like Kansas State Polytechnic Institution, Haskell Indian Nations University, many institutions of higher education, Harvard Medical School, Dartmouth College. You can just name the list, okay? I'm naming some places I've had the good fortune to visit. And I think what we need desperately is sort of to shift our worldviews in a way so that we can quit behaving so badly on this very fragile planet that we live on. I shouldn't say fragile planet. We have a fairly fragile, biosphere, that thin layer that goes around this planet, where our biological life lives. the planet's pretty resilient, to be honest with you. We might not last long, but the planet will continue to operate. In fact, if I were going to change the title of my last book, which was Red Alert, Saving the Planet with Indigenous Knowledge, I'd take that notion out of sort of saving the planet, and I think I'd say, you know, Red Alert, you know, improving the planet with Indigenous knowledge. Because I think what we need to do is to step back from the anthropocentric thinking that we have that dominates the kind of culture we're a part of, and really come up with a different kind of value orientation so that we can live well on this planet. So that would be my first sort of reference, that apocryphal quote. Again, if you can find the citation somewhere, let me know. But it is apocryphal. I've heard it used many times and never been able to find out exactly when he said that, okay? Another quote by a very wise individual who always had an opinion about everything that I think is relevant for this presentation is Mark Twain's comment about what we think we know. And some of you have probably heard this quote before, but this is classic Twain. And his remark was, remember, it's not what you don't know that gets you in trouble. It's what you think you know that just ain't so that causes all the problems. And what you think you know about Indigenous people, for most of you, is wildly wrong. What you think you know just isn't so. So, let me start. I'm not going to say anything original. I'm going to basically talk about my work for the last 31 years with Indigenous people all through North America, largely, you know, by virtue of being at Haskell Indian Nations University. How many have been to Haskell in this room? Great, fantastic. Please come visit again. If you haven't been there in 10 years, we have a new cultural center and museum. It's not a big building, but it's a start, and it's doing a very good job telling the story of Haskell. So what's my message today? Well, my message is going to be very simple. We need to find different ways of thinking, different solutions to the problems that humankind has created. And I think Indigenous people, in many ways, have a deep repository of wisdom that we could implement and that has tremendous advantages over the kind of the dominant thinking we have about how we, humankind, solve problems. Okay? So my first point would be the following. Imagine a world where you thought of the spheres of politics and ethics as inclusive of plants and animals on the planet. See, it's only unusual in outside of native communities to find people with the name Wildcat. I'm used to working with people called Running Wolf, called Stumbling Bear, called Deer, called Rabbit, because in our social organization of our peoples, our clans, our social organization came directly from the ecosystems we participated in. We participated in, with. So I'm related to that four-legged wildcat. That's in my way of thinking. Jameson Bear of the Osage Nation is related to the bears, their kin. Now, you might say that's romantic unless you really go back and think of what modern evolutionary theory teaches, and we really are all related, but we're not the same. The most important thing that we can take from indigenous traditions is this awareness that until very recently, who we were culturally as human beings was absolutely shaped and defined by the environments and the ecosystems that we called home. You can start teaching a geography class to any seventh grader, and once you describe to them the North Maine woods and the Everglades of Florida and the southern plains of Texas and the canyons of New Mexico and the northwest coast environment for Coast Salish peoples, and if you ask them, well, do you think those peoples all dress the same way? And they say, well, of course not. Are you stupid? Seventh graders, you have to be college educated and get a PhD to forget that. That most, until very recently, our cultures, our human cultures, were products of ancient, centuries-long symbiotic relationships between people and place. We need to restore that because we live as if places are all the same, or else we'll make them all the same. And we have no longer, we don't identify in dominant society by clans. I guess you identify by your shopping habits. You know, so just based on your clothes in here, I think we've got some Walmart people. We've probably got some JCPenney clan members. And for you uppity folks, we've got Target and Macy's maybe. I don't know. If we had brought the Osage from the east, the Kanza, the Pawnee, they were pretty much here, actually, the Pawnee, the Wichita from the south, some of the people from north, maybe some of those Lakota bands that dared to come into Pawnee Nation. If we had had a meeting here 200 years ago, people would have identified who you were by how you were dressed. People would have had ceremonial traditions, religions, that were deeply tied to the life they participated with in the planet. So you go across the southern part of the United States, and the predominant relationship that is honored in our quote-unquote religious traditions or ceremonial traditions is our relationship with corn. You go to the northwest coast, those Coast Salish peoples, their ceremonies are about orca, killer whale, about salmon, about raven. Why? Well, that's who they shared their home with. And of course, we all know the most incredible life that dominated the plains, bison, the American buffalo. So from Comanches and Wichitas to the south, clear north, you know, to peoples. What were ceremonies surrounding that sacred relationship with the bison? For my people, the corn. For Coast Salish people, the salmon. Now, we have something called cultural diffusion. As populations expanded, people moved around, okay? People borrow things from different cultures, share things. I'm not arguing against diffusion. Cultural diffusion, that's a fact. That's the way things work. But what I am arguing is that, as my mentor, the late Vine DeLoria Jr., used to say, we've got to reconsecrate, acknowledge that history resides in places too, not just time, but in places. We need to reconnect our histories with places. And then it sort of has this necessary consequence that if you think your history is always going to be about this place, you might take a little better care of it than if you're just planning to move on. after you get your degree. We're always moving somewhere, going somewhere, okay? Point one, and I'm going to make 3 points very quickly, so we'll at least have 20 minutes, maybe 25 minutes for questions. I'd love to hear your questions. So point one would be this, is that what indigenous people offer are what I would call, in a different way of thinking about, deep spatial worldviews. They're worldviews that have to do with places on the planet where they've lived, where their homelands, where their identities came from. They've been keen observers, and they know something about these places. They know they can offer insights on what would be something good to do there, what would be something bad to do there. And we could avoid a lot of mistakes. Now, I just went to a history conference. I'm going to give a very practical example, okay? I'm going to give a very practical example. I just went to a history conference, the Missouri Valley History Conference in Omaha, with two of my colleagues and two of my students last week. And I was driving up, 29, north of Kansas City. And if you notice that whole highway, you've got those bluffs on either side. And you realize after about 60 miles, I am driving in what used to be, before the Corps of Engineers channelized the river, the Wide Missouri. It's not an accident that you have such, it's also farmland all the way up. I was giving a presentation at St. Joe about 15 years ago, and I was railing against the stupidity of building in floodplains. I said, you know, if you build in a floodplain, you should expect to get flooded, you know. And one of the students asked me, well, okay, Dr. Wildcat, what would you recommend? And I said, simple, move, okay? But don't be coming to saying we ought to build more dams or the like. I mean, technology is so important to us, but we have to find those, I guess the language used to be appropriate technologies, those sustainable technologies. We have to find technologies that fit places and peoples. And so, you know, I have a low tolerance for people who are complaining about being flooded when they live in a floodplain. That's not a good thing. And if you would ask the Dakota, Beatrice Medicine, Vine Deloria Jr.'s cousin, who Deloria is a very important family in the Northern Plains. Vine's probably the best known, although his son's a scholar and continues to write. Philip Deloria got a great book called Indians in Unexpected Places. But Beatrice Medicine, I heard her tell a story one time about how they farmed on the Missouri before the Pick Sloan Dams process has pretty much made that impossible. When they still had the Wide Missouri, she said, yeah, we would plant our gardens down on the floodplain. She says, but we never set up camp there because it floods. Okay, we'd go plant our gardens. Vine writes about this in Indian Education in America, Power and Place, Indian Education in America, that they had such a good knowledge of the seasonal cycles, which now is uncertain, but at that time when she was a small girl, she said they could put their garden in, then they could go off, and they could look, even if they were out in the middle of the plains, at what the flowers and the plants were doing, and they knew when certain flowers appeared or certain things happened with the plants, they knew it was time to go back and harvest. These things are related, but you have to be paying attention to know that, okay? You might say, well, that's just common sense. It's only common sense if you have the experience of living on a river for thousands of years, and you know you're not going to set up your village in a floodplain. If people who developed Kansas City and St. Joe and St. Louis had talked to the native people, they would have said, slow down, you better back off a little ways. Okay? One example. The diversity of place-based knowledge that Native people hold is what we desperately need today. It's about that symbiotic relationship between people and place, between culture and nature or environment. If you understand that, the next three points I'm going to make can go very quickly. Wildcat, stumbling bear, beaver, all names you'll come across at Haskell. Rita Beaver, Barbara Stumbling Bear, Eugene Running Wolf, Dan Wildcat, George Tiger. Someone asked me one time, well, does that mean he was one of the real Indians? Did he come from India? Well, I said, no, I just think when they were doing the translation of big cat, someone said tiger. So, one of the things that we could do, and I'd say modern evolutionary science supports it, environmental science supports it, is that if we wanted a dramatic change in how we lived and how we thought about things like what people call sustainability, or today what people use as the buzzword kind of resiliency, I would say the most radical change would be to adopt that indigenous view that the political and ethical sphere is not just a human-centered sphere, but it involves all life that we participate with, and we're not in charge. The most distinguishing feature of, I would say, most indigenous worldviews in North America is that they are decidedly non-anthropocentric. Anyone who would claim, a human who would claim to be smart enough to control nature, would be demonstrated in most traditional settings as a very dangerous and crazy person. Second point, what I'd formulate this way. What would happen if we left this room today and we decided, you know what? We're going to shift our way of thinking, and we're going to begin to relate with the land, the air, the water, the plants and animals, no longer as resources. See, resources. Resources for whom? See, that's the that's that sleight of hand. That's intrinsically anthropocentric. Oh, resources for whom? You know. Let's move from a worldview where we look at the balance of nature as nothing but resources for our use to being constituted of relatives that we must respect and work with. That's a tremendous shift in worldview. Now, it has another benefit. This would be my third point. Once you begin with that first point, that everyone, oh, by the way, everyone in here, you know, didn't raise your hand when she asked you were if you were indigenous or not. I've got to correct you, because if my good friend Thomas Binyakua, a Hopi elder, were here, he would say, oh no, he says, you're all indigenous, you've just forgotten where you came from. Everyone in this room has a history much longer in your family tree of people living as tribal members than you do of citizens of modern nation states. You've just forgotten that history. And in the worst case, you've made the error that Twain warned us about. You have become civilized now, so you don't need to remember that. No, that forgetting comes at a very high price. Let's move from social organization, economics, politics, science. By the way, science is the institution that's closest to actually, you know, just sort of embracing that, if you really think about it. the most pressing problems we know today are really the fact that to understand these problems, we have to untangle all the various relationships that produce that problem. They're not simple problems. They're not things we can study in an experimental design setting, control setting. It's not that easy. We move from living in a world with resources to one with relatives, which then leads to Standing Rock. If you stand with Standing Rock, if you stand with all of those native peoples and many non-native peoples who joined the thousands at Standing Rock to oppose the Dakota Access Pipeline, you understand, if you listen to the native speakers, why this was such an exercise, an affirmation of ancient ways of conducting ourselves. Because the native people on site repeatedly emphasized the fact, we're not here protesting, we are here as water protectors. That's not trivial. That's not trivial, because it goes to my second point. We have a political sphere where we think living well is all about rights. Oh boy, don't step on my rights. That's my right. If I want to do that, that's my land. That's my right. Again, if you came to Yuchi ceremonial grounds and you heard our chief speak, you would never hear a discussion of rights. What you would hear, not in these words, not in this kind of academic way I'm talking, but what you would hear is a reminder, an attempt to make us remember that rights must always be countered with inalienable responsibilities we have because we live among many relatives. And our ethics, our politics, are no longer in Congress or the State House. Our politics are right outside this door. And how we conduct ourselves well with our relatives. What would happen if we started a political movement that said, let's talk about inalienable rights, but we've left something out. Let's also talk about inalienable responsibilities we have as members of these larger life communities. I don't think there's anything romantic about that. I call that indigenous realism. And that's what we need today. Now, the fourth point, and again, these first three, all the last three here, build on that first picture I want you to keep in mind, that throughout most of our human history on the planet, our cultures, our identities, were products of symbiotic relationships we had with landscapes, with seascapes. That's why we were so diverse. And that's why it's quite true today that we still find the most biological diversity on the planet where indigenous people remain and hold out against people who want to build large dams and people who want to, you know, rearrange and deforest areas. That's why we still have the most biological diversity there, because they don't live among resources, they live among relatives. To live well means taking care of that home. If we could do those two things, move from resources to relatives, move from a discourse about politics and ethics that's entirely grounded in rights, and also counterbalance that with inalienable responsibilities that we have, then what I would argue is we could really start to think about reframing what we think progress is. For peoples around the planet who've often been victims of ideologies of progress and civilization, I would argue that what we can re-explore is a notion that what progress really ought to mean from through indigenous eyes is that we're not creating a world for our comfort, convenience, and benefit, but we're trying to live in a world, create, innovate, the term I like is exercise indigenuity, in ways that produces systems of life enhancement. Not anthropocentrically defined life enhancement, but we actually go into places, and if we live well, we don't see the precipitous drop in biodiversity. Which, let's face it, if any of you've looked at the ICUN website, if you look at any of the, the World Wildlife Federation, Nature Conservancy, I mean, the riddle we have now is that, when our relatives see us move in, human beings, they're thinking, there goes the neighborhood. Because biodiversity declines rapidly when humans move in. It doesn't have to be that way, but it will be if we continue to create problems and think we're going to solve them with the same kind of thinking. My last point would be, unlike my title suggested in 2009, I don't know that we're going to save the planet. And people ask me about that. Well, that sounds very, Western. God, what kind of hubris is that? You're going to save the planet. And it's a good point. What I was thinking about when I chose that title was just the notion that when I participated in Al Gore's SOS World Program in 2007, Save Ourselves, I felt really uncomfortable because that kind of, well, it's all about saving ourselves. And I thought, well, that doesn't fit with my Yuchi teachings. It's not about saving ourselves, it's about saving our community, which includes plants and animals. I would argue, even if, and again, I'm not making this claim, but someone might say, oh, it's too late. It's humankind's going to be a short experiment. So why bother? Well, I'll tell you why I would bother in a Yuchi way of thinking, is that ultimately, as I leave something for my children and grandchildren, I would like them to say, Grandpa tried to save, enhance some of that life on the planet that others seem bent on using up, and sometimes destroying. I'd like to be thought of that way. I'd like my relatives, I'd like the crows, I'd like the coyotes, if they have any wildcat stories, to say, he was a good wildcat. We could move from this. I'm down on sustainability right now, and I'm talking to a very well-educated group. I'm going to stop with this final comment, and we've got 18 minutes for questions. I'm hoping you've got lots of questions. But I'm down on sustainability now because everyone's for sustainability. And when Shell and BP Oil tell me they've got a sustainability plan, I'm thinking, I don't think we're talking about the same thing. When you say you're all for sustainability, I think we better have a discussion. So, what am I for? Let's see if we can all work together to create systems of life enhancement on this planet. And the people at Standing Rock weren't protesting, they were protecting. Water is life. And so they'll lose that, they're going to lose that case. Because as Walter Echo Hawk would say, when you step into the court of the conquerors, their legal principles are about property and rights. They're not about responsibilities. But that means we're going to have a lot of opportunities to stand together as responsible human beings to stop some of the insanity we see going on as we continue to mine the planet. If we keep treating the planet as if it's an ATM machine, where all we're doing is withdrawing money out of it, one of these days there's not going to be anything left. Let's try something different. Let's see if we can exercise some indigenuity. Thank you very much. I'd love to hear questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wildcat. Let's have some questions.
Questions.
On the floor.
Yeah, over there, yeah.
What would be...
Oh, wait, we got here and then... Yeah, okay.
Yeah, how would you... You know, when you talk about life enhancement and some of these different philosophies, how would you view, how do you view a solution for the ever-increasing population mm-hmm. of humans, which is really to some extent, I mean, that with, you know, cultural issues
right,
of
right,
consumption
right.
and everything else. I mean, it's a complicated situation.
Mm-hmm. It is.
But the reality is that the population mm-hmm. is increasing exponentially, and that puts extra pressure on natural resources. Could mm-hmm. you comment on that?
I think again, you could look at the fact that, so thanks for the question. That is a great question. And there would be many population ecologists and environmentalists who would say that's the primary driver at this point. Is population. I'd say there are two things that we ought to think about from an indigenous perspective. And one is, if you're thinking about, you know, not just your life, but life in that broader context, you do what many Native people did, and you practice birth control. You practice population control. Who was the governor of Colorado? Was it Lamb? Who got in a lot of trouble for basically pointing out that, you know, gee, there's something, you know, everyone wants to live forever now. And he said, you know, that might not be a good strategy. You know, I think about this a lot. You know, God, you get advertised constantly about living forever and extending your life and living longer, longer, longer. And, you know, Native peoples had, which might seem hard solutions, but, you know, they practiced, you know, when a person could no longer keep up with a band that had to move, they were often left behind. Why? Because the community could not support that. Now you might say, oh, God, that's horrible. That's awful. No, let's just keep people living forever, put them in nursing homes, and have them live isolated lives the last 10 years of their life where they can't even get relatives, human relatives, to come see them. That's civilized. Really? Is it? So I'd say we're going to have to deal with the issue of population control. Now, the second thing I'd point out about that is, and I know here, since we've got a lot of people who study science, if you've ever done population ecology, the main challenge we have is that in people who are in abject poverty, and we could think of Central Africa in many ways being an example of this kind of logic, that the reason people say, well, why do they keep making babies? Because babies are your only insurance policy for old age. You know you're going to have a lot of babies that will die. And you know that as you age, you will need children that will take care of you. So it's really their Social Security policy. It makes sense only in that environment, which means what? Which means that basically we need to address the food issue, which may be the most serious issue on the planet. And I'm of the opinion now, like many food scientists, that the question isn't we don't have enough food at the present time. The question is the economic system through which we distribute food. And you know, people starve because they can't get food. And we could address that. We could address that. But we don't, and I think it's probably because some people are thinking about food itself as a resource. Just like some people are proposing water has to be thought of as a resource. You know, yeah, everyone should have to pay for water. In fact, let's increase water. This is how insane it is. So if I had told my paternal and maternal grandparents that I would stop on the way and buy a bottle of, 32 ounces, 28 ounces, I don't even think it's that, 20 ounces, and I'd pay $1.50, you're paying more for water than you are the petroleum fuel you put in your car. And we act as if that's normal. That's insane. My grandparents would be wondering, what kind of crazy world is Dan living in? People are paying $1.50 for a little thing of water. Well, we've got to address those kinds of things. But thank you for the question. It's not an easy answer because that's where we got to have a lot of institutions that are going to have to kind of get on the same page in order to solve it. People keep making babies.
Hi, Dr. Wildcat. First of all, on behalf of the Indigenous Alliance at K-State, thank you for being here.
Well, thank you for the invitation.
And second of all, so I'm curious to know your views on how do we bring indigenous knowledges into the STEM classrooms?
Mm. Easy. Every STEM course should be now moving towards project-based learning. Have students work on a real problem, maybe one on your campus. Maybe one in your home community. This is what we're pushing at Haskell. It's not reading out of just a textbook. It's like, let's solve a problem. And what this means is that you have to start develop skills that are highly devalued in the way that we teach science today. And here's what I mean by that. I'll give one example. So you can get an electrical engineer, you can get a plant ecologist, you can get an ag science PhD, okay, and then you can get an atmospheric scientist in the same room, and if they talk about their research, they might not even understand what each person is talking about because their language is so highfalutin technical that they can't even communicate with each other. If you work as a group to solve a problem, the biggest problem you will have is making your classmate, your colleague, understand what you're saying. And then coming up with a shared definition of what the problem is. And I think that's indigenuity. That's what you have to do if you're going to solve these wicked problems that have all these relationships. The truth of the matter is, we do need the electrical engineer, the atmospheric scientist, the ag scientist, the ecologist, all working on a problem because each of them has some knowledge that would be relevant to solving that. But that doesn't happen in universities. They all have their silos. And we've got to break that. So the thing that we can do is let's start working on ways to get true interdisciplinary project-based learning going on. I think that would be a great step forward.
Good question. Dr. Wildcat, we have four or five questions from the floor by cards.
Okay.
And I think we have another one from the floor.
Okay.
So I want to just kind of keep you aware. So one participant wrote, what was the original educational function of Haskell Indian Nations University? And I guess that would extend to when was it founded? If you could
1884. It should be a national landmark. My colleague Eric Anderson and I, if any of you would write your congressional leadership, our senators. There's no place on the planet like Haskell Indian Nations University. It started in 1884 in the bad old days of the Indian boarding schools when Richard Henry Pratt's motto for the experiment of the off-reservation boarding schools at Hampton, the Freeman School created in Hampton, Virginia for runaway slaves, and freed slaves. When he brought Indians in, his motto was, kill the Indian to save the man. The notion was our humanity, the only obstacle to us being full civilized human beings was the Zoyaha language and philosophy, the Pawnee language. So the schools were attempts to completely strip Indian boys and girls of their cultural identity. The only way to do that is remove them from their families, remove them from their communities. And unfortunately, we have a graveyard with, I think, 134 marked graves, 137 total, where we have children who were never returned home, who died there, away from families. And part of that experiment. So Haskell is an incredible institution because now we've morphed from that to a school that talks about indigenous philosophies, indigenous science, that teaches languages. We've taught Lakota, Diné, Chickasaw, Choctaw, Cherokee, and those are important. When we have the people available to teach those languages, we try to do so. So it's got a great history, and it should be a historic landmark. We need to talk to the Park Service and get them to designate it one, because that would help us with our funding, because then the Park Service would create some money to help us maintain that institution.
We have another from the floor over here.
Yeah.
I'd like to hear your thoughts on humans exploring outer space.
Yeah. I think everyone who wants to do that, we should build as many ships as we can and get them off the planet as soon as possible. Okay, I'll help start a fund to those people who want to leave. Let's get them off of here, because see, they're already invested in the idea we're going to destroy it all, and so you know those with deep pockets are going to go into outer space. So my view of it is, let's get those people off the planet as soon as we can. So I'll pitch in to buy them a ticket, you know. But I will send a message. So, great story. Again, Thomas Benyakua, this great elder, a Hopi man, he had this story. Now, I don't know if this is true or if this is just one of his jokes. American Indians have great senses of humor. I don't know where the stoic Indian thing comes from. I have no idea. Well, I do have a theory. But he said, you know, when those astronauts came, they put something and left it on the moon, and they went to the Navajo Nation and asked them what message they would put or what they would put in that box for future people to find. And Thomas used to say, we sent a message, we wrote it out in Navajo, and we put it in the box and left it there on the moon. And someone said, well, can you tell us what it said? And it said, don't sign any treaties. Don't sign any treaties. So again, just great senses of humor. We had a question. Okay, yes.
Yeah, first of all, thank you for coming. I guess my question would be, if society overall took the relatives opposed to resources mindset, how would it affect the economy?
Oh, I think this would be really exciting, in fact. I think what it would mean is that we would really start looking at desegregating agriculture from the larger part of what we do. I think that so this is going to sound like a slam, and I know places like K-State and other land-grant institutes get a lot of money from agribusiness, but what I think the challenge with agribusiness is agribusiness is vested in monoculture production. That's not natural. That's unnatural. So what we need to do, is support people like Wes Jackson and the Land Institute and say, let's talk about restoring a bigger family, a polyculture family of life on the plains. And that is real science. There's a lot of work to do. And I think, again, that means that it's going to have to be done probably outside the confines of agribusiness that seems very convinced to continue a monoculture they're going to specialize in. Corn, wheat, soybeans, and large acreages of those. The more natural way of growing would be to have polyculture, so you had all of this mix of plants that you could live on right outside your backyard. We need city planners. We need ag science people. We need botanists. We need ecologists. We need economists. Some of you guys know, just a quick plug, ecosystem services. I've got some critiques of that, but in principle, I understand what they're doing. The people who are working on economists, who are working on ecosystem services models, are trying to calculate the value of a grassland prairie and its polyculture. I don't like the idea of calculating a value, but I get their point. They're saying in this system, that's the way it works. So if you can demonstrate that there's actually economic benefit, potentially profit, in leaving forest alone, leaving wetlands alone, then maybe that's the way to go. I haven't made up my mind about that, but I get the intent, and I think it's interesting science.
Thank you. I have a couple more questions from Cars. What can we learn about climate change?
Oh, I tell you, what we can learn about climate change is all the people who I think want to deny climate change spend their whole time living in spaces like this. Because if you're paying attention, something's going on. I've lived in northeastern Oklahoma, southeastern Kansas, and since I got out of the Army in 1974, Lawrence, Kansas. And I'm seeing things. Okay, now scientists would say, oh, this is just anecdotal. Well, I've been paying attention. November 1st, Lawrence, Kansas, right here on Interstate 70. Sitting on my deck because it was extremely warm. November 1st, go back and look how warm it was. I killed 2 mosquitoes. Mosquitoes are the most dangerous tropical disease vector we have, and the mosquitoes are staying here longer and longer seasons. Guess what? The climate's changing. Now, that's one bookend. I celebrated my 2-year-old granddaughter's birthday. She was born on the 18th, but I think it was that was in the middle of the week, so we did it on Saturday or Sunday, about February 20th. And we're sitting in North Lawrence, less than a mile from the river. And my sister-in-law's at my son's house. Again, on the patio, it's so warm, we're having a cookout. February 20th, in shirt sleeves. My sister-in-law says, I just killed a mosquito. And I said, Shelby, there aren't any mosquitoes. Within the next minute, I killed 2. Something's changing. I don't think you need anyone. The fact that we have people who can't believe there's climate change tells you how we have insulated ourselves into ignorance. We live in insulated ignorance. And if I hear one more person tell me, we got to learn to think outside the box, I'm going to scream. Look at where we're sitting. We're in the box all day long, and then you get in your little box with four wheels, and you go riding around. No. There's a reason why we think in boxes. We live in boxes. Let's figure out ways to design buildings very differently, where we can open walls. I always like it. Rich people do these things, right? Rich people do these things. So they build houses where they've got retractable walls and retractable. I'd like to have that. In fact, the Yuchis used to have that. When we lived in Georgia before removal on the Savannah River, we spent most of our time living in arbors in the summer. And arbors, four poles, thatch roof over it, okay, keep you out of the sun. An open-air dwelling. It also was easy to put up a wall if you had a storm going. You could take the movable wall, lean it up against the side to protect you from the wind and the rain. We have central heated, central air-controlled spaces, and we wonder why people don't. The only way they know the weather and what's going on outside is when they turn on their TV or radio and get the weather report. Our ancestors were much smarter about these things than we were, and it was based on experience. Thank you very much. Do we have time for one more? Or? I know it's a little after one.
I didn't know what your schedule was. Well, I guess I'll conclude with one last one, we'll make it short.
Okay. I do have, so here's the deal. If you're intrigued by some what I've talked about, I've got three different books here. I've got the book I wrote with probably the person who's considered my mentor and the person who's considered the dean of American Indian scholarship in the United States, Vine Deloria Jr., a Dakota man who grew up on the Pine Ridge Reservation, scholar, theologian, lawyer, just an incredible intellectual. Power and Place, Indian, so you want to know more about this place-based stuff, Power and Place, Indian Education in America. My mistitled book, Red Alert, Saving the Planet with Indigenous Knowledge. And then a book that I've got an essay in that is a great work by the Mennonite. It was published, the funding came from the Mennonite Church of Canada, who's taking a very active role in starting a discussion between the First Nations peoples of Canada and the Mennonite Church about religious respect and understanding. And so, Buffalo Shout, Salmon Cry. And I've got a few copies of those three books for sale. And, you know, here's a gift idea. If you really think, man, I don't want to ever have to listen to that guy again, buy one of these books and give it to someone you really dislike. Okay? You know, say, here's a present for you. Okay? So anyway, Mado, that's what my Muscogee relatives would say. Thank you. And thanks, Greg, for arranging this. And I'm going to tell the Yuchis to hold off. We're not going to file our lawsuit about you appropriating our clan for your mascot. Okay? We're going to hold off on that. You know, we're going to catch you some slack. But anyway, thank you very much for the invitation to be here.
Thank you, Dr. Wildcat. Renee, you said what we can do if we don't like you, but if we do like you, do you have something like a website? I'm almost embarrassed to ask, but do you have any of these modern-day things like
I
that?
I don't have.
Website?
I am
a podcast,
sort of...
Podcast, anything like that with your...
If you go to YouTube, I guarantee you're going to find more talks of me than you're ever going to want to listen
good,
to.
Good. So, thank you again.
Yeah,
let's
so go to YouTube
and
just do a
thank you.
Searching.